Well, that's not too bad. Good morning. Now let's stand. It's time to worship and praise the Lord. Amen. First, we start off with our verse. Say this with me. Praise ye the Lord. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart in the assembly of the upright and in the congregation. Now let's praise him for his presence. Come on now. Yeah. Now let's sing. You may be seated. Wow, what a good-looking crowd. But you ever notice when people address a crowd, they always say how good-looking they are? What if they got up and said, man, y'all look bad? Hurt your feelings, wouldn't you? Well, some of you look like your mother-in-law moved in and sold her suitcase. Hey, we're Baptists. You know what we do here? We take up offering. We'll take up an offering and buy our new one, all right? Now, all of God's children said, amen. We're so thankful you're here. Wow, what a beautiful day. We're really glad you're here, especially our guest. Our guest, when you came in, you received a bulletin, and toward the end of that, there's a little portion there we ask you to fill out. And then remove that from the rest of the bulletin. At the end of the service, you'll have an opportunity to give that back. And in the meantime, while you do that, all of Trinity's going to stand. We're going to sing a chorus. We're marching to Zion. We're going to come and shake your hand. So, Trinity, let's stand.
We're marching to Zion. Beautiful, beautiful Zion. We're marching upward to Zion, the beautiful city of God. Thank you.
Lord. Y'all have a seat, and all our children, please come forward.
All these youngins, Malachi, I owe you an apology, buddy. I'm so glad you're here. Malachi decided that he's going to be a little rebellious this morning, and I found out I needed to be the one prayed for, not him. When he saw this lady right here, he decided to act right. That's when you know you got the right lady working with these kiddos. One look at her, and he said, I'll behave. I'll behave. And then they got Brother Chuck back there. He's a heavy, you know, so... What she can't handle, he's got. Did you bring your handcuffs? Hope you don't need them. Do we have a mission video this morning? Miss Tiffany, let's watch that mission video.
I got into the building ministry about 11, 12 years ago. Me and my wife surrendered to full-time missions 13 years ago. I am not a builder by trade, but God has raised up the ability for me to learn all of this. The Arkansas Baptist Builders is a ministry of the Arkansas Baptist State Convention working with community missions. We are contacted by local families, individuals, churches, or associations that has a specific need. Once we have that need and know of it, we go down and meet with them and assess it and schedule it to be done with volunteer labor. This is a very viable ministry just simply because we have so many residents and smaller churches in our state that needs assistance. We're at a home in Monticello right now, and this gentleman needed a lot of assistance. One of the things we do in the construction ministry of Arkansas Baptist Builders is we make sure that we do get a chance to share the gospel with the homeowner. And if they are a born-again believer, we try to, we want to know their church, and we will inform their church of their needs so they can step in and assist us. And while we're on job sites, there's always opportunities from neighbors across the street, the neighbors next door. It's never ending, the opportunities to share the gospel.
Wow, so glad that our church has a heart for missions. And I saw so many things there that Trinity actually takes a part in as far as our prayer ministry on Monday nights and our ladies' prayer ministry, our park ministry. We had 20 folks from other churches join us last week to go pray around the park and for the community. And I wish I could share some other stories with you, but you'll have to come join us on Monday night. So get involved in missions any way you can. And youngins, I just want y'all to know, it's because of a mission emphasis that these two folks, they love y'all so much that they make it part of their mission to be able to minister to you. So we're going to pray for you guys right now, and then y'all are going to be dismissed. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for loving us. And we just thank you for these young people, these young kids that are just learning to love you, learning to understand you. And Lord, I pray to say thank you for raising people like Chuck and Sheila that just have the gift of being able to love these kids when sometimes they're hard to love. A little bit of a confession there, Father, but we thank you so much for the greatest gift you ever gave us, your son Jesus. And it's in his name we pray. Amen. Y'all can be dismissed.
I know that when Brother Mike's here, we pretty much follow the order of the bulletin, but guess who's not here? So guess what we're going to do? We're going to change it. I didn't realize at the first of the week when I put the music together what was going to take place. I didn't realize at the time, I did not know until the middle of the week that I would be preaching today. And so these particular songs that we're going to do is going to kind of forefront the message. So allow us to do that first, and then the choir is going to sing a very special song. So would you stand with me, please, as we sing two old familiar hymns.
That tug of war at me all day long, I struggle with answers that I need, but then I come into your presence and all my questions become clear. And for this sacred moment, no doubt can interfere.
Oh,
Yes, we're in the presence of the King.
As the choir comes down, would you join us in this time of special prayer? Turn with me, please, to the book of Matthew, chapter 7. The book of Matthew, chapter 7, please. Begin reading in a moment in verse 21. I walked in today, early service, and a very unusual thing happened. And I say that because it doesn't happen in the church much anymore. I walked into the presence of two gentlemen before we could even say our casual greeting. Immediately one of them grabbed me, embraced me. The other one came and embraced me, and they just began to pray. I did not ask them to. As a matter of fact, I was surprised very pleasantly. Several months ago, back in the early part of the summer, I had the opportunity to preach a revival up in Morganfield, Kentucky. On Sunday mornings, I sit in the auditorium, and there was not a Sunday school class there. The pastor was in his class, several things. People were coming in. I just sat there, just kind of going over what I was going to do, and an unusual thing happened. A man and his wife picked up their two grandchildren and brought them and set them down on the altar, embraced them, and began to pray for them. Other people just doing their thing. A few moments later, another man came over on that side and just fell down on his knees, and he began to pray. No one instructed him to. No one had to lead them in to do anything. They just did that. And then a lady came down on this side. She later informed me that she is 80 years old. And she said, the reason I pray that way is because I had knee surgery and I cannot bend it. So instead of kneeling down at the altar, she grabbed hold of the rail and forced herself to lay down prostrate upon that altar. And she prayed. And she prayed. That's the way it ought to be. Amen. 2 weeks ago, I went over to Oklahoma to preach a revival. And the Lord gave me a message. It was right in the midst and all of the wildness of Harvey and Irma right on his heels and all the destructions that was taking place. And it continued. And on the day before I went there, God gave me a particular message. When Brother Mike asked me to preach this week so he could go play with his grandchildren, I really thought I was going to preach that message because it's very present and needful. But instead, yesterday morning, I got up and God gave me a message off an experience that took place just a week ago. Would you stand with me, please, as we begin reading in chapter 7, verse 21. Jesus is speaking, and he says, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And then I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will liken him unto a wise man who built his house upon a rock, and the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine, doeth them not, shall be likened unto a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell. And great was the fall of it." Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, again, I approach you with all caution, in all awesomeness of your presence. And Lord, my first reaction, Lord, woe is me, as did Isaiah. "I seek you for cleansing of any and all unrighteousness, that I be guilty of nothing other than following your leadership. I pray, Lord, for the anointing that you've given to be fresh and anew. I pray, Lord, for total recall of how you've given this to me in the order that you would have it proclaimed. Lord, I pray that we do not see Johnny or hear Johnny. I pray we just see Jesus. May we indeed sit in the presence. May that presence be so strong that, Lord, hearts begin to change even before the message is done. Lord, for those who truly do not know you, yet playing along a game, I pray that their hearts are melted before you, even before we're through, and may they call upon you. Lord, we know not the hour. So I pray your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. It's amazing to me, the media, how they'll do everything they can to downplay God. And they'll upplay everything and all those trying to do away with that. But then they'll come right along and follow somebody that will say, the world is going to end September 23rd. Well, it didn't. Today's the 24th. And here's what was so amazing. They followed it up and said, well, it's probably going to end. And this was the news media. I read it yesterday or Friday. Said it's probably going to end, but it's not going to happen tomorrow. And they were right. It's not going to happen tomorrow or the next day, because there's, even when the church is called away, there's still at least 7 years left before all the destruction comes to a term. So those kind of things, they like to play those things up. But now let's get where I'm going. Jesus described of all the people in the world, and he was truly talking about that last judgment we've talked about before. And of all the people in the world, of all the dialects, all the languages, and all the races, and all the religions, what he comes right down to, and there's only two groups. Just two. Those who do it right, and those who do it wrong. In the political scene, there are two groups. There's the liberals, there's the conservative. Now, I know there's a group called the moderates, but they're just waiting on the teeter lane to see who pays them the most to get them on their side. And that's about all they're used for. But either way, there's only two groups in any situation. So allow me, if you will, for the next few moments to follow what the Lord has given me, and I don't know how it's going to come out. I don't know how long it's going to take. I really don't. But let's just take your watch off. Not a time for watching, worried about a football game. Turn your phone off. It's not a time to get a call from Aunt Susie. And kids, if you're in here, this is not your bedroom. You don't lay down and sleep. We're going to listen to the Word of God. Amen. There used to be a time years ago that we did it by the book. It's time we got back to doing that. Let's talk about these two groups. And I'm going to put them in this first order, the first group, those who did it right. And Jesus mentioned that in that first verse we read, to him that doeth the will of my Father who in heaven. And that first group, I begin to, as the Lord is laying this out for me, and that's the name of this message, and they did it right. And I begin to glean through scriptures, and I just chose one. I came to the book of Exodus, and you know that was the mass exodus when finally Israelites were freed from the slavery of Egypt. But it took them a while, and Moses finally got it right with God after 80 years, and now he's their leader. And they go through the plagues and all the things going on, and Pharaoh and his court try to mock them and copy them. But then in chapter 11, we come to the 10th one. And it was proclaimed to Pharaoh and Egypt and all the house of Israel. The death angel was coming at midnight. And all the firstborn in every household throughout the land, including the beast, was going to die at the hand of the death angel. But then in chapter 12, the remedy was given. God said, put the blood upon the lintels and the doorpost of your household. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you. I know the movies have made it look like that some of Egyptians follow me. I don't know. I don't know who did or did not. But I know as a whole, the nation of Israel put the blood on their doorpost and they, in a massive way, made an escape. They did it right. All the others trusted in their own gods. They trusted in their own ways. They trusted in their riches to buy them out with their own God. They did it the wrong way. I move forward to another book, the book of Ruth. Only four chapters. And the book of Ruth is about Ruth, but it begins with Naomi and her husband, and they moved because of the famine in the land of their nativity. They go to the land of the Moabites. She has two sons. And they marry Moabitish women. But soon after, the husband dies. Then the two boys die, leaving Naomi and two daughter-in-laws, Ruth and Orpah. Naomi looks immediately at them and said, at the girls and said, it's time for me to go back to my nativity. And I urge you to stay and marry in your own land and do whatever. But the young ladies insisted, no, we will follow you. And again, she turned to him. She said, I'm too old to bear you another son. And by the time they're of age, you would be too old. I urge you to go back. Orpah turned back. But Ruth said, your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. She did it right. Orpah did it wrong. So what does it mean just to do it right? Jesus opened his Sermon on the Mount with this beatitude, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is, not will be, not hopefully, theirs is. In other words, proclaiming at that moment, theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed, the word is to be approved of. God, Jesus said, approves of those who come to him in complete bankruptcy, spiritual bankruptcy of sin. That's what poor in spirit means. I've never experienced bankruptcy. I pastored my first church down in southeast Arkansas and it's primarily farmers. And of all the farmers, several have it gone through because they've made bad choices or whatever. One in particular was a man in my church, how he suffered through bankruptcy and had to recover. And from what I know about it, in order to successfully get the court to approve of that, you have to give up everything in your name. Give it over to the courts for their division. That's bankruptcy of spirit. In order to immediately receive that kingdom of God, there has to be that moment of total surrender of all that you are for all that He is. Folks, what a glorious grand exchange that is. I cannot for the life of me understand why people refuse to make such a grand exchange. I don't understand that. Jesus said in order to do it right, Matthew chapter 7, verse 13, he said, "Enter ye in at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be go." Then he said, "Because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it." I immediately moved over to Matthew chapter 18. And Jesus told all of those around, "He who cometh me in the same fashion as this child, he who humbles himself," he said, "as this child, they become the greatest in the kingdom." In Matthew 19, a young man came to see Jesus, said, "How can I inherit eternal life?" And Jesus told him not only about the obedience which he proclaimed to have, but he also told him, "You must surrender all that you are in order to gain that which is better." In John chapter 3, Nicodemus was a man of the Pharisees. He was a member of the Sanhedrin. And the scripture is very clear that says when Nicodemus came to see Jesus, it was by night. He did not know, want anyone else to know, especially Sanhedrin, that was taboo. But he came to see Jesus by night and began to talk to him. And Jesus immediately said, "You must be born again." Nicodemus questioned that. And Jesus, in our own vernacular, explained to him there must be an exchange by the power of the Holy Spirit. You must be born again. And in John chapter 19, Nicodemus came out of the dark. He joined a man by the name of Joseph Arimathea who prepared the body of Jesus for burial. He did it right. In Revelation chapter 12, verse 11, "And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony." The blood. The only hope of doing it right is when God says, "When I see the blood, I will pass over you." Those who do it right, they speak differently. They go from cursing to praising the Lord. They walk differently. They go from seeking evil to seeking righteousness. They go from walking in hatred to walking in forgiveness. As John said in 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, when he said these words, "But if you walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship therefore with one another, and his blood is always cleansing us from all our sin." In Matthew, Jesus also taught Peter how to forgive. When Peter asked about it, he said, "No, not just seven times, but 70 times seven." In other words, "Peter, if you can count that far, you just keep on doing it because that's what I do." This is called the ones who did it right. That is their fruit. But let's quickly go to the other group for a moment. And then Jesus proclaimed it in that other group when he said in verse 22, he said, "Many will say to me that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, in thy name done many wonderful works? And then I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." This is the group that did it wrong. This is the other group. Go back to Matthew 19 and that rich young ruler who came to see Jesus and, "Master, good master, how can I inherit eternal life?" "Obey the commandments." "I have done that, Lord. Surely that accounts for something. I can see that pride swelling up." And then Jesus says, "But where's the surrender?" I know what he said about the money, but it's all about giving up. It's about total surrender. And the young man chose to do it the wrong way. He clung, if that's a word, clinged, held on to his riches, and went away sorrowfully. He did it the wrong way. In the book of Ruth, when Orpah chose to go her own way, the Bible is very clear to say that she kissed Naomi. That was an Oriental custom, that when you kiss somebody in that manner, It was a gesture of departure, never to see you again. It makes me wonder about the kiss of Judah that we call the kiss of betrayal. When he came in and kissed Jesus when they arrested him, did he realize that maybe he was following that same custom when he would never see Jesus again? Turn with me, please, to Matthew chapter 22. I want to read you a story that Jesus told. Matthew chapter 22, and if you get there before I do, just start reading. I'll catch up with you. That's on page 1029. Verse 2, Jesus is speaking. The kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who made a marriage for his son. He sent forth his servants to call them that were bidden to the wedding, and they would not come. And he goes on the next three or four verses how he sent them again. And finally, they just slew his son, made mark. And we know this is a picture of Israel rejecting Jesus. Let's go on. Verse 7, but when the king heard of it, he was angry, and he sent forth his armies and destroyed them. Verse 8, then saith he to his servants, the wedding is ready, but they who were bidden were not worthy. Go therefore into the highways, and as many as ye shall find, bid to the marriage. So those servants went out unto the highways and gathered them all, as many as they found, both bad and good, and the wedding was furnished with guests. And when the king came in to see the guest, he saw there a man who had not on a wedding garment. And he saith unto him, friend, how camest thou in hither, not having a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Then said the king to the servants, bind him hand and foot, take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you ever wondered about the particulars of that particular parable? What Jesus was saying? Verse 8 tells us that those special invited guests that was invited first did not come. Shamefully entreated all of his servants, so he found them unworthy. Then in verse 10, there's another phrase, both bad and good, and then it says, as many as they found. Literally in Greek, that means they came just as they were. Another rendition of this, some of them were crippled, some of them were maimed, and they all came just like they were. And the Bible says there in that verse that the hall was filled. Now, we go down to a verse, and the king walks in, he sees a man who did not have a wedding garment, and we know the story, got cast. Well, what happened? Why did he get cast? Where did the rest of them get their wedding garment? They didn't have one. When they were invited, they didn't own one. I mean, how many of you got up yesterday, put on your best tuxedo, your best gown, ladies, thinking, I'm going to be invited to a wedding today? You didn't do it. You didn't do it today. You won't do it tomorrow. They went out into the streets and they got them to come just as well. Here's another custom. In those days, if you were invited to such a feast, in such a place, everything that you wore was furnished by that king, down to the very shoes that you were to wear. Everyone became alike. And to get in, you had to accept that wedding garment. But somehow or another, the king finds one there in that verse that did not have on a wedding garment, and he asks him, how did you do that? And there's a phrase there, and the young man was speechless. I like that. Because it tells me he was standing there bragging how he got in. Man, I got my own business. I got a lot of money. I'm an influence in this town. That's a king. I'm special. I'm sure maybe somebody else, where's your wedding garment? Well, man, you just don't know. I've got a lot. I'm different. He's kind of like the rich young ruler that prided himself in the riches. He's kind of like those that Jesus described. Many will come to me that day saying, Lord, Lord, look at all the good things we've done. But they did it wrong. And this young man did it wrong. And instead of wearing the righteous garment of the king, he wore his own garment of unrighteousness. And he did it wrong. And he was cast out. In John chapter 6, You don't have to turn there. Verse 44, Jesus said, "No man can come unto me except the Father who sent me draw him." And all he said was, if you've never been broken by the Holy Spirit, you've never been saved. He repeated that verse in verse 65. "Therefore I say again unto you that no man can come unto me except it were given him of my Father." Same thing. In verse 66, the very next verse, after Jesus reiterated that, the Bible says, "From that time on, many of his disciples went back and followed him, walked with him no more." The word disciples there does not necessarily mean they were his children. It meant they were students. It's kind of like the church today. We're bombarded with a lot of members, but not all of them are believers. We have two groups. There are more students. There are more disciples. There are more church members than there are believers. Recently, an experience happened to me that's never happened before. I was called and asked to do something I've never done. I've sung thousands of songs. I have never sung the national anthem in a service by myself. Judge Leon Holmes asked if that I would sing the national anthem at a naturalization service in our Justice Department in our state capitol. Now, I don't mind telling you, when I arrived, I first thought, well, there won't be very many people there, but I'm going to do it. First, I didn't want to, you know. Well, I got there, I was surprised the room was full. They treated me like royalty. I walked in, they immediately ushered me back to a room. "We want you back here." There was Judge Holmes in his robe. There was Representative French Hill. Gosh, that guy's tall. He stood up. He kept standing up. I enjoyed Judge Leon. He was short, you know. And I began to talk to them and immediately felt a spiritual likeness with them. I worked every day on that national, because I did not want to do it wrong. When it was my turn, I walked over in front of the flag. They immediately stood up and I began to sing. We were all excited. The room was filled with excitement about what's going on. But the most excited ones were those about to receive their citizenship. There were 50 there. 26 different countries. Now, part of this naturalization ceremony is they must go through 8 months of preparing. So therefore, they have to learn to speak at least a little English. Every one of them, after they took the oath, began to line up. And they came before the microphone that I had sung on, and they began to, and they told their name and where they were from. Most of them went on to say, "I just want to say thank you for letting me in your country." They were excited. One lady in particular came up, and she spoke very good English, and she was so glad and said, "I'm so thankful that I'm a part of it. It's finally happened, and when this is over with, I'm going to celebrate." Well, you can imagine whatever she was going. But they were excited about the fact that they were being made citizens. Every day, our borders are bombarded by illegal immigrants. They'll do whatever's necessary to enter in a wrong fashion. They'll try to blend in. They'll try to work. And they will just try to be in a place where nobody notices. But sooner or later, they will be hunted down and sent back. They remind me of the young man at the wedding feast who had on the wrong garment. Blended in the wrong way. They did it wrong. But to that group of people that I had the honor of singing the national anthem for, they did it right. They did it exactly right. Remember what Jesus said in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13. He said, "Enter in at the straight gate." I talked to you about that type of surrender. May I read to you the oath that they took? Allow me to do that. They were standing, They had their hands up, and they were smiling. The man led them in this, and this is what he said. You hereby declare on oath that you absolutely and entirely renounce and abjure all allegiance and fidelity to any foreign prince, potentate, state, or sovereignty of whom or of which you have heretofore been a subject or citizen, that you will support and defend the Constitution and laws of the United States of America against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that you will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, that you will bear arms on behalf of the United States when required by the law, that you will perform non-combatant service in the armed forces of the United States when required by law, that you will perform work of national importance under civilian direction when required by the law, and that you take this obligation freely without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion, so help you God. I do. At that moment, they completely surrendered everything about them, anything they had to do with another country, in order to become a part of this country. That's a type of salvation. It's not about what you say, it's how you receive. That precious gift is yours. All you have to do, as they did at that wedding feast, come just as you are. Make that exchange. I surrender all that I am. And immediately he gives all that he is. They performed a type of salvation, but there was also a type of baptism there, because in taking that oath, and baptism is nothing more than identification. They identified themselves by immersing themselves completely under all the statutes of this land. Two groups. One did it right, and one did it wrong. Go back with me, please, to our original verse. And let's look at the two groups. I'm going to reverse the order and I'll be through. The group that did it wrong. Many will come to me saying, look at all I've done. Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? I can just see them gloating over that. Lord, surely they're saying, and remember, last year, I guess it was, I preached a message out of Revelation chapter 20 about that final judgment. Satan's already been thrown into the lake of fire forever. The final judgment, the sea gives up the dead, the grave give up the dead. All of those who said they'd never been before God are there before his presence. Books are opened. And I kind of think as I preached that it was a chance for them to review. Then there's one book. And what it all amounted to, if they had a chance to proclaim themselves, he would say, well, let me look in the book, and if I see the blood, I will pass over you. These group are standing there before Jesus. Lord, have we not done all these things in your name? Lord, I've got riches. Look at all the money that I've given to the church. I've given to the building program. I've given to this program. Surely that accounts for something. May I tell you what the psalmist said? They that trust in their wealth and boast themselves in the multitude of their riches, none of them, that is their riches, can by any means redeem his brother or himself. That group that did it wrong was cast out. But the other group, I read about them again in Revelation just yesterday. Revelation chapter 7 verse 11 says, and one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these that are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they? And I thought, this may be that group that think they're the only ones going to be in heaven. Well, there's going to be others. Verse 14, he said, I said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he said unto me, these are they which came out of great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. These are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb wheresoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men being therefore the first fruit. When we close the ceremony in the state capitol, Judge Leon Holmes said, "From this moment on, you're just as much of a citizen of the United States as I am." And I thought, wow. Did you know, for those of you who have been saved, the very moment you surrendered yourself to the Lordship of Jesus, at that very moment, you were made just as much a citizen and a part of the kingdom of God as an heir, just as much as the Apostle Paul. And for those of you who have never humbled yourself before the Lordship of Jesus, if you do that today, the very moment you do, you will become just like the apostles. You will be one of those who have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb. You will be one of those, when he said they overcame him, that is the evil one, by the blood of the Lamb. So that when you stand there, God say, "Because I see the blood, I will pass over you." Which group are you? The most important question you'll ever be asked. Which group are you? Stand with me, please, every head bowed and every eye closed. And Father in heaven, how we praise you, O Lord, for the opportunity, and I thank you for the peace already. So, Lord, I move back. I step out of the way, and I pray the Holy Spirit right now will begin to work. I pray we don't wait for a note to play on the pen. I just pray, Lord, that we obey. I pray for those who do not know Christ today, and there are some here, as in every service. I pray for those who do, but are not walking where they need to be. I pray today, Lord, the Holy Spirit will manifest itself in such a supernatural way that lives are changed. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Right now, as the music begins, would you come?